Mr. Del Brazil? Present. Ranger Christensen? Victor Garza?
Here.
Coach Monkey?
Here.
Monique Cressis?
Here.
Mr. President, have a form.
Thank you, Madam Secretary. We will move on to prayer and pledge. Mr. Scott, who we have tonight?
We have Principal Teresa Triana, so Ottawa Victory is a special guest. Welcome, Ms. Triana.
Thank you. We do indeed. That's a lot of, we teach our kids to be leaders, and so tonight our students are going to be leading the board presentation.
Good evening, Mr. Toscano, School Board President, Mr. John Massengel, and the Board of Trustees. My name is Amy Cuzzo, and I am a third grader in the dual language program at Salado Elementary. We have Jackson Monk, a second grader in the dual language program, and Cameron Duplechain and AJ Triana, fourth graders in the East Central Leadership Academy, to help us lead us in the prayer and pledges this evening. Please stand.
Heavenly Father, we come to you today asking for your guidance, wisdom, and support as we begin this board meeting. Please guide the board meeting in meaningful discussion. Allow us to nurture the bonds of community. Fill us with your grace, Lord God, as we make decisions that affect the students, staff, faculty, and friends of East Central. And continue to remind us all that we do here today, all that we accomplish is in consideration of the students you place in our care. We ask these things in your name. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Yo prometo lealtad a la bandera de los Estados Unidos de América y a la república que representa una nación ante Dios, indivisible, con libertad y justicia para todos. Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to the Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible. Honra la bandera de Texas, juro lealtad a ti, un estado ante Dios único e indivisible.
Please be seated.
At Salado Elementary, we not only focus on students being leaders and the literate, we focus on students being multicultural as well. On May 13th, students performed in the Salado Fine Arts program at the East Central Performing Arts Center. We have performances that display different cultures and genres of music. We also have students display their talents in art and photography. Please enjoy this short video, which showcases the talents of students from Salado Elementary.
Thank you.
The student, staff, and parent volunteer did an amazing job putting this a lot of fine arts event together. This evening, you are going to be in for a treat. Tonight, we have pre-K and kinder students from both the dual language program and the Leadership Academy going to perform a dance for you this evening. This dance's title is Bandera Mi Casa. Please help me in welcoming Ariana Castro, Daniela Aguilar, Elizabeth Duplochain, Everly Monk, Naila Pozo, and Jareni Luevamo.
Casa.
have to help showcase this wonderful event, family and friends of these amazing Salalah students. Please stand up to be recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Toscano and the Board of Trustees, for your continued support. We have a small token of our appreciation for your commitment to the Salalah community and the East Central Independent School District.
Great job. Thank you all very much.
Thank you. I think I have some future meetings and
recognize some very special students, and if we could get Ms. Samantha Nass to come forward. She is a 2022 graduate, so she just walked the stage, but we want to congratulate her. She is a future business leader of America, and she placed first in public speaking at State for Future Business Leaders of America. Chicago in a couple of weeks, and we want to call up her sponsors, Lisa Jordan and Corey Johnson. Where are they at? Oh, they're all awesome. Thank God for being here. So, way to go, y'all. Good job. Miss Samantha. For Odyssey of the Mind, and we want to say congratulations to them as well. Ms. Gomez, who is their sponsor?
We have two, but Faith Moore here and Carrie Garcia.
Faith Moore and Carrie Garcia are their sponsors, and if the parents of these students would please stand up and be recognized. Thank you all so much for supporting these amazing students. Thank you all so much. Congratulations. Thank you. Next, we've got two National History Day, National History Day state winners. They're advancing to nationals which will be virtual in D.C. And from Legacy, we've got David Farget and his sponsor, Ms. McClain. And then from Heritage, we've got Jesse Hale and his sponsor, Ms. Garcia. You guys are coming in. Congratulations. Let us know how that virtual trip to D.C. goes. All right. They're actually in D.C. right now. Awesome. Congratulations, guys. Will your parents please stand and be recognized? Thank you guys so much. It's also very special for another reason. We are honoring some of our very special employees tonight with employee recognition. And so if we could please have Courtney Mize and Sandra Macias come forward. I don't think Ms. Courtney could be here, but we have Sandra Macias come up. And these ladies were nominated in the category of collaboration, and they were nominated by Heidi Pease. Ms. Courtney Mize and Ms. Sandra Macias have been collaborating throughout the school year to start a student work-based learning project that combines the culinary program and the special education vocational program. These two teachers came together to get a coffee cart up and running and provide authentic work experience for the program, and the teachers really loved it too. So thank you, ladies. We appreciate y'all very much. Ms. Macias, you have family here. Will your family please stand and be recognized as well? Thank you, Mr. Macias, for sharing your wonderful life with us. Next up, Mr. Paul Kowalczyk. Please come forward. Paul was nominated for teamwork, and he was nominated by Mr. Keith Moore. Paul came to East Central ISD 5 years ago after retiring from the New York school system. He is a foreman over the building mechanics and grounds department. Paul is always helping other departments when asked. You'll never find Paul idle. He's always looking for something that needs repair or preventative maintenance. We call Paul our East Central MacGyver, because if we are ever met with a challenge, Paul can come up with a plan on the fly. I remember when Paul was interviewed, he said, "I still have fuel in the tank and I want to share my knowledge." And he's done that, and we appreciate it very much. So thank you, Paul. Paul, do you have any family or friends here?
Yes, I do. The back row, basically.
The back row, back row. Thank you so much for sharing your wonderful Paul with us. We could please have Ms. Brenda Miller come forward. Brenda Miller is nominated in the category of diversity, and she is nominated by Ms. Emily Miller, her daughter. Yeah, it's pretty cool. They're like the dynamic duo teaching together at the high school. They're amazing. Not only does she donate her time, resources, and compassion to organizations across the campus, whether they're related to her subject and club or not, she also works with students of incredibly different backgrounds. Her heart is open to students of all ethnicities, gender identities, orientation, nationality, and background. She is well known for her ability to increase interest among students who struggle with apathy in school. Her organizations bring together students of vastly different upbringings, bonding them for life. And we know this to be true, and we thank you so much, Ms. Miller. Will Ms. Miller's family and friends please stand up and be recognized as well? Next up, we'd like to call up Mr. Castro, Mr. Elmer Castro. Yes. Mr. Castro is being recognized tonight also for diversity, and he was nominated by Amanda Holman. Mr. Castro has been an integral part of the GT education program refinement. As we evaluated data, we identified populations of students that were underserved by our GT programs. Mr. Castro was able to help our CCMR department, along with his GT facilitator colleagues, identify ways that ECISD could identify giftedness through different lenses to be more inclusive of all students, regardless of race, gender, ethnicity, ability, and more. Due to this reframe, we were able to identify more gifted students than we have ever identified in the past, bringing us closer to our goal of closing gaps among students of varied ability in ECISD. Thank you, Mr. Castro. Where is your lovely bride and your son? Please see them. Miss Lauren Bryn Long, please come forward. Also being recognized for diversity and also nominated by Dr. Amanda Holman, Ms. Long has done an exceptional job of decreasing disparities among our GT identification process. After reviewing historical data, she noticed that young boys of color and emerging bilinguals were identified for giftedness at a lower rate than their peers. She immediately dove into research around these disparities and ways to close these gaps. Due to the efforts of Ms. Long and the GT facilitators, the district was able to utilize data to identify and increase the number of students for GT services evaluations. This increase in evaluations also resulted in more student qualifications for GT than ever before based on data and screening committee evaluations. We are so proud of the work that Ms. Long and the GT facilitators have done to provide equal opportunities for all students. Thank you. Long, is your husband and cute little baby here? They should say that. You recognize too. Thank you so much. All right. Next up, we would like to call Sarah Jones, Patty Cantu, Esther Huron, Elvira Chavez, Veronica Cervantes, Macy Gooch, Donna Martin, and Amanda Real. If you ladies could please come forward. This team of colleagues from our district, if you don't know, they are counselors, SEL coordinator, and special ed director. This team of colleagues spent several days in Uvalde providing emotional support services to families and community members in their darkest hour. Their generosity of spirit is commendable, and we wish to extend our gratitude to them for representing the East Central ISD community in support of the Uvalde community in the aftermath of the tragedy at Robb Elementary. We thank you, ladies, from the bottom of our hearts, and we appreciate you very much. Will the family and friends of these ladies please stand up and also be recognized? Because I know there are probably people picking up the slack at home for the 3 or 4 days they've been home with you guys. So thank you. Thank you all for supporting us and our support of Uvalde. Thank you all so much. That concludes our recognitions for tonight.
Thank you.
We're going to move on to public comments. No public comments? All right. We will move on to... Trustee reports. New items for the agenda. Board of trustees to do. We're going to start doing monthly trustee reports. So I can tell you real quick that I'll let some other trustees expand if they want to, but right now, currently, we are participating in SLI Summer Leadership Institute, where we continue our education to get our credit hours for the state requirements. I know back in March, we went to Galveston, a few of us, and it was really good to get back to having in-person conferences. Now, I'm not a big fan of virtual or anything, but it was nice to see, especially some of the other trustees that you know me, and it's always good to see them and talk to them and see how the other school districts are doing in the state of Texas. But today, I guess I wasn't there all day, like with some of the other trustees, but one thing I did like was I went to a conference or a session that was had to deal with trustee and superintendent relationship. And so I can tell you real quick, trustees, look forward to possibly a small workshop that we're going to do in the future. So it was really a good session, I would say. So, but anybody else here, welcome to have anything that they'd like to say or report on while we're doing this.
Before school was out, I was invited to tradition for career day. So I got to take my paints and painting and all my stuff from my custom painting for my shop. And I was able to set up a table, and the kids came around every 15, 20 minutes, and I got to talk, you know, which is hard to do, but I thought I had really good. But I got to talk to them about how I opened my shop and what I do there. And then I got Van Gogh, and we talked about a lot of artists, and I could explain to them where they could look up and learn about the other artists and stuff like that. So it was really super cool. And then before school was out, we got to go across the street to the Cass School, and we got to have the kids present ideas for businesses to us. And I was just amazed at how smart they were and how well-spoken they were and how realistic and real in today's world your ideas with kids. So it was really a nice opportunity. I appreciate it being invited to this meeting. So, yeah.
Sir, trustees, in your electronic packet, you see this month's personnel activity. Always the month of June and July are very, very active. Looking back at June last year, this is always something that raises an eyebrow when we see from one month where there's no activity to June, where there's all of a sudden a couple of pages of activity. Our attrition, teacher attrition rate last year, this time was 17%, 16.5% this year. So actually, during a time when the state is seeing a greater attrition rate of teachers than in previous years, I was actually a little bit surprised to see that it was a little less than last year. That being said, know that resignations come before recommendation. So next month, you'll see a lot of these resignations reflect being filled. We have actually hired, or in the process, or have hired 125 new teachers. We've added 26 new teacher positions for next year due to student enrollment growth and some of our program expansions. And we currently have about 34 teacher positions vacant that we'll be recruiting and interviewing and hiring for through the summer. So we're actually right about where we normally are this time of year, given all of that. And so I just wanted to make sure the board was aware of that. Of course, any activity that you see in this month's report or in future reports that you want to know more about, please reach out to me and we'll get you on the board.
Okay, thanks, Paul.
Yes, sir.
Just a quick question of the 125 new teachers. How many of y'all have recently graduated? I'm just curious to see, like, how
many. From college? Yeah, so we don't have that distribution yet, but over the last 5 years, we have seen a gradual decline in average years of experience.
Okay, good question. I'm just curious to see if there's a couple of interesting.
Well, to that point, the Higher Education Coordinating Board is reporting that as of last year, students entering into the college or university and choosing careers in paths in education is down to 3%. It usually was between 14 and 17 in the last 15 or 20 years, pretty much an average. So we've definitely seen a decline in these things and folks entering even college prep programs and for careers in education. So we've got to do a lot to recruit and retain. It will be new to us this year. And 26 of those are new positions we actually added. So those 26.
So the teachers that are no longer here for that, so they all be interested in interviews?
Yes, sir. Yeah. We'll provide those. Usually we provide about once a quarter. We'll provide a summary of that interview reports. Usually in September, we'll do the first quarter, September, October. And we internally definitely are aware of whether they left for promotions, whether they left that. For life reasons, or whether they left the profession, or whether they left to another district.
That's good.
We'll share that with you.
Yes, sir. All right, thank you very much. We'll move on to 7.2, Maintenance Department Update. Mr. Scott.
Yes, sir. I'd like to invite John Thomas to keep more focus this time to provide board an update on the progress of the the new presentation, of course, is on the monitor. You have your copy in your miscellaneous packet. Your preference, anybody following on. Oh, thank you.
I think we do very good on the
video. Why are we getting that? Ladies in the room today, you all know them because they've been with us the better part of the last 15 years in various roles, from teacher to leadership positions. In SBK's case at the high school, and in Salter's case at a couple of different campuses. But these are two of our newest principals. Ms. Varnikosha will be taking over as the new high school principal beginning next year. So we're very proud of Ms. BK.
Teaching in learning environment. We do several trainings. We have weekly
FM meetings. We meet with our foreman regularly. We attend some Red Fire seminars, members of CASGO. Some of our projects we've been doing, we're doing HVAC replacement, upgrade lighting, additional lighting to LED. We replaced some boilers. And one of the best tools we've gotten this year is called Turf Tank. And Turf Tank has been named one. Turf Tank is a GPS field-driven field marker. It allows us to mark our athletic fields in a fraction of the time with office personnel, thus allowing us to use that personnel to do other projects. Example being, we mark a complete football field in about an hour and a half with one person. Whereas before, first time we marked the field, it would take six guys about 4 to 4.5 hours. So we save a lot of resources there. We also do monthly playground inspection at every playground and report people report those. Our high-performing engaged workforce, all new employees, we put them on our calendar for 30, 60, 90 days, and we visit with those employees to make sure, number one, that they're happy and that they have all the tools and resources they need. If they need additional training, we get that training for them. Again, we have weekly facility management meetings and formal meetings.
One of the big things we did this year was to add a facilities management side. It allows for transparency within our department, and we can kind of push some of the information that we're doing, some of the projects that we have to know going on, out to the staff out in the district. We can maintain our life and safety inspections, so that we can do our knock-off, basically our boiler inspections, stuff like that. And have a tracking mechanism for them so that we know that all our life and safety, fire alarms, fire extinguishers, those things are done every year so we can keep track of the site. The replacement schedule, we've expanded going through the district, evaluating the data, what we have, so that we know what our replacement looks like, so we can forecast out 5-10 years down the road what our HVAC replacement looks like, what our capital outlay is going to be. Capital improvements expenditure is all on there, so everybody in our department can know kind of where we're at, what we're doing, so that they can engage with us in some of the decision-making processes. The maintenance calendar we came up with recently so that we can be transparent to the staff out of the school, the projects that we've got.
Inclusive and collaborative partnerships. We have several that we work with on a daily, weekly, monthly basis. A couple of the big ones we were awarded, as we all know, the SM2 and SM3 grants, and those have been a lifesaver for us. We're in the middle of getting all of those projects kicked off. Another grant, two grants we have, the single grants for interior and exterior lighting. We converted, let's see, heritage, legacy, cafeterias. We did some exterior parking lot lighting to conventional LEDs. Nice thing about that, it saves energy, and we're also getting a rebate on top of the grant, too. Of course, we deal with CASB a lot. Some of our biggest partners that we work with is SAW, obviously for our water, but then also CPS. CPS is a great partner for the district. They work with us when we have problems. They're quick. If we have power outage, we have a point of contact we reach out to, and they get on the right way and get our schools back up and running. Priority four, our operational excellence. We've got a new software program. It's called Kiox. That's an asset management program. We've got an overlay of every facility in the district, and in that we can go to that school, if you would, and go drill down to that room, and it'll tell us all our assets that we have in that room. For example, air handlers, AV devices, fire alarm, pull stations, and all those. Allows us, when we're having some issues, we know exactly what we're at, where it's at, and where we want to look for it. And of course, we partner with Dude Solutions and School Dude, our work order system, and then our district energy management program. Again, that's where we curtail energy. One of our biggest things that we do there, again, with CPS, we do every year we participate, and I can't remember our partner in crime, he retired last month, so I'm a little dismissed on the days, but Several years the district has participated in the PR events, the demand response. If my memory's right, we're around $500,000 in rebates from CPS. And also, when we do conversions on traditional light to LED, we get rebates there. And we're right around another $400,000 or so that we got rebates from CPS. Our Clear Results, which is a partner of CPS.
So in conclusion, we've still got some things we're working towards this next year. We're going to look at doing replacement schedules on roofing. We're spending a lot of time on roofing now, right now, evaluating our roofing so we can begin to forecast that out over the next 10-year period, as well as the parking lots, some of the parking lots and pavement projects. You see one that's obviously coming out right out front. Just to evaluate those and see what we look like on a 10-5-year period of time. So, as well as we're doing a little bit more training, putting some training programs in place here with the staff. So, that's a look at what we're doing. Do y'all have any questions?
That's the base station. We set, there's a certain spot every field that we mark, and we set that up every time. And there's a base station there. And generally communicates between 18 and 25 satellites. And we set that up first, and we let it start running through its little program to get that. And then we turn on Wally, and it'll link in there. That is who Wally is. Yes. So the nice thing about it is cloudy days, rainy days, muggy days, it's going to mark every time the same way. It's within about 3/16 of an inch most of the time, even on our rough fields. It's good straight lines. And one thing we did too is when we programmed it, Heritage football field gets a big H in the middle of the field, and Legacy gets a big L. Now, I don't think there's a middle school in the county that gets their logo on their football field. So I know the coaches from told me that other schools at Danielle's field coach. Mine for sure. So we like walking.
Yeah.
And you still look to work every day.
I did request the next time y'all do it.
Absolutely. Okay. Probably when spring football starts, about 2 weeks before school starts, we'll be marking the lower and upper soccer fields for Coach Hubbard. Absolutely.
I'm going to save you a lot of money on paint because I just wanted a laser tripod and mark out the shot put or the discus. It's a new laser system so we won't have to paint.
What, Ariel?
Thank
you. Mention on that.
$4,000.
Before you guys sit down, I did notice that Nick Bollett was in the room.
Yes, sir.
Hey, Nick, stand up for a minute. I'm going to introduce you to the board. So Nick Bollett's been with us about 6 years. We were really glad we were able to recruit him from Lawrenceville. He's our new senior project manager. He's over energy management and HVAC. He's an HVAC master technician. He's been doing a fantastic job as a foreman over that group before he moved into this position. He's hit the ground running. So proud of you, Nick, and glad you're in the role and glad to have him.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. All right, so we can move on to 7.3. Athletic Department update.
Well, I'd like to introduce the infamous Miss Ariel, who has already made it into this evening. Your athletic update is in your miscellaneous packet before you can follow along electronically.
No, I am.
Comes
to
ride,
so. Some of you might have ended up with one of those somewhere before.
Library always works well.
Good evening, Superintendent Toscano, Board President Massengill, and members of the board. Tonight, we're here to celebrate athletics and a great year that we had in 21-22. Something we're very proud of that we created and started this year was our Assistant Coaches Academy. That was, we wanted to bring all the tools to all of our assistant coaches that we could and our middle school coordinators so that we could share that down at the middle school level. We wanted to make sure that everybody was armed with everything they needed to be able to be successful. Hopefully one day our job is to train them up, that one day they'll become a head coach at Central and hopefully not leave us, but we're preparing them. We're looking to extend that program down to middle school next year, so we are very excited about that. Our athletic department, case management, this is our data. And so this is what we collect data. We started about 4 years ago looking for grades, behavior, and attendance so that we can be proactive and take a look at how kids are doing in classes or their behaviors that we see and looking for different trends throughout our departments and different programs so that we can have those conversations with the young men and young ladies to try to prevent some of the things we see them going down a road of bad attendance or their grades start to flip off. But our data collection looked a little bit different this year. I'll just say ascender. It is our trend, and we are going to work to get better with that. But data is important. It drives decisions that we make. So we want to continue to improve and refine that as much as we can. Priority two, we want to work to develop people to know what the EC way is. We're not lucky enough to get all the coaches and kids that graduate from EC. And if you know the EC way, then you know what I'm talking about. But if you're not from East Central, they have to learn who we are and what we stand for. So about 5 years ago, Mr. Toscano and the athletic department and the board and we had the community involved and we created the Pillars of Success. There's 12 of them. So one of the first things we do in our staff development is understanding, making sure all of our coaches understand what those pillars are, what being at East Central means, who we are, what we stand for, and remember that that's a reputation that goes throughout the city and throughout our region. That's something that we take very seriously. We continue to grow in all of our professional organizations. We have state and local representatives on just about every board that our coaches participate in our professional organizations. Our routine check-ins and procedures, we have the weekly check-ins, the meetings, the roundings, all the things that we continue to do because when we implement something, we want to make sure that it's being implemented and that it's not just being documented and that the coach just isn't checking it off the list. So through our surprise visits as well as our planned visits, we continue to check on our coaches to verify. We trust them, but we always want to verify that what we would like in place is happening because we may find out that it's not working and maybe we need to adjust that and make some changes to that. Priority three, this is where we really strive. Our partnerships, we grow those in numbers each and every year in strengths. We have great partnerships from our support staff to our vendors. We merge ourselves in the newest technology possible, especially through COVID, that we were able to find ways to connect to our kids and our families and our communities and our all the coaches around the city and state, you know, through Coach, through Sports U, through Rank One, and of course there's Twitter. But we research to try to find the best ways that we continue to grow with our community and our kids and everyone and all of our organizations. We engage in our community partnerships. We are going to continue all of our district partnerships with our booster clubs, our campuses. Big shout out to the maintenance department, the custodial department, the transportation, the ROTC, all of our administrative staffs at our middle schools and high schools because we cannot do what we do without them. So big shout out to them. Priority four. So we remain a little agile with the COVID. We say we're out of COVID, but we're really not out of COVID at sometimes. What I'm really proud of is that we continue to adjust our COVID protocols. We never just threw them out the window. There's still a COVID protocol manual in my backpack in case anything were to happen. We continue to adjust them. And very proud that in the 2 years that we went through this, East Central never forfeited one game. We were one of the very few schools that because we were so stringent with our protocols that we were able to continue to play through there. So So hoping next year I can take that manual out of my backpack and maybe put it in the shelf so we don't have to worry about that. Continuing with our budget and inventory management, Miss Judy has been fabulous in working, creating our rotational plans with uniforms and helmets and shoulder pads, and continuing our audits monthly. I audit every activity account. Mr. Davis and me every month that report, we take a look at it. There's quite a bit of money in there that they've raised, and that's because we're starting to go back out of town for some of our tournaments, some of our teams that need to see a little more competition than what is offered here in San Antonio, as well as they are starting to buy some new technologies in every sport, so they want to buy some of the new sparkly, shiny things. But I do appreciate Ms. Judy and her flexibility with the budget. In conclusion, just the case management is something that we are going to continue to refine. We want to get better at this year. We're hoping we got all the kinks worked out, but that is something that's very important to us, so we will continue to work on that. Continue to expand our assistant coaches program down to the middle school. We're also going to reach into our youth programs, as well as we're going to start something you are welcome back this year. It's going to be the Senior Coaches Convention, kind of trying to bring a coaches school atmosphere to it, so that everyone can get a lot out of that. Then our budget, we are the only 16th district in Central Texas. So for us, we are going to have to travel a little bit more to finish filling out our schedules. So that's something that the student and I are trying to work through in our budget for next year, get to add some travel and to look at that, but we will continue to work on that. And then of course the officials for some reason would like to get paid a little bit more money. I'm not sure about that, but we'll get into them. But I'll tell you that the biggest aha moment for me as I did this, when we say in conclusion and what are we going to work towards, is myself, because there are a lot of great things going on at our middle schools, and I don't celebrate that enough. We don't celebrate that enough. So we need to be better at that. So one thing we will work on is making sure that all of our middle schools, we have some district stack champions that we celebrated throughout the year, but we need to bring that more to the forefront to make sure that they are getting the recognition. The administrators do a great job in supporting us, and we need to be better making sure that we're supporting and celebrating them. Last two quick slides, because I know y'all count my minutes. Just a quick glance, just to let you know, these are the things we did. We were in playoffs, we moved on to regionals. This picture in the right-hand corner of my writer over there, that's Mr. Wyckoff. He does not have a daughter or a granddaughter in our program. But this man, he rides his little scooter all around from the neighborhood through transportation back our way every single morning. He is at every softball practice. He's at every softball game. He travels. And we went to Ryan. All of a sudden, here he comes in his truck, and there he is. That's the impact that our kids have on our community. So I can't begin to tell you how proud I am of all of our programs, middle school to high school, the celebrations, the advancements that we've had this year in athletics, and we're just going to continue to build. We have record-breaking numbers right now in strength and conditioning. Every day those kids are out there working in skill, as well as in summer camps. Every week those numbers right now are also off the charts. So we thank everyone for their support. We couldn't do it without you, and I'll take questions.
Doing an amazing job, and I really appreciate that case management. I know we've always emphasized, great student athletes, and I really, really appreciate that.
We didn't lose very many for any eligibility reasons this year. We did a plan for our best years, but I won't lie. With some of the issues we had at times, look it up. But the coaches, every time we had something that wasn't correct, it was to the teacher to make sure that we were good with that kid. If we had any questions, to make sure we weren't, breaking any rules. But it was a little tough, so it'll be better next year, definitely.
Thank you so much. Yeah. That's amazing.
Good job. Great job.
Yes. Thank you, Mark.
You're in the Spurs season. I work out there. Mm-hmm. And I was wearing a mask with the EC on it. And I got nothing but praise for our community. They would ask me, is that EC? I thought it said exceptionally charming, but that wasn't me. But I admit it. Yes, it is EC. And I have nothing but compliments for our community. It's just good people, good sports. So, what you're talking about is recognized. I was just doing my job and receiving these people, but the EC was on their attention. And everybody recognizes and everybody's heard it.
And so, we try to remind our coaches to remind our kids that at any point when you're wearing that EC, people know where you are now. They know what you're representing and to make sure you're always representing that EC.
So real quick, so I have a story today from SLI, another one. So anyway, I was at SLI today during break from one session to another, and there was a fellow trustee from Justin ISD that approached me and introduced himself to me, and he said that they were so mad this year that from last year's season, losing the East Central, and it's been such a long time that they lost the East Central that they fired their head coach. And I told him, I said, well, we're going to continue that tradition of firing Justin head coaches for the continuing season. So just FYI, that's what I told him. So.
We're doing everything in our power to make sure we do that.
There you go.
That's
what our goal is, new tradition.
Everybody's got goals. All right, we're going to move on to 7.4, Curriculum Department Update.
Trustees heard quite a bit with Dr. Fuller in the Curriculum Department last week at the special meeting. So she brought some of her team with her tonight to provide the update. These are folks that you all know, but you don't always get a chance to hear from them. They're brilliant and amazing. Jonathan, you will hear from Jonathan, you hear from him all the time. But the others are with him today, and so, yeah, he's not going to be with us today.
Wow.
Angel. Dr. Fuller, turn it over to you.
Good evening, President Mascio, Susana, Board of Trustees. I did bring my amazing team tonight, so we have Jonathan Bulwark, who's Director of Transformation, Jennifer Casper, who is Director of Curriculum Instruction, Dr. Coleman, who's Director of CCMR, and Dr. Martinez, Director of Bilingual, and Amanda Holman, Director of Special Education. So they're going to be
Thank you.
not quite as tall as her, not at all. That makes sense, sure, I like scoring priority two for us. And so our department intentionally designed this process is to hire and mentor new staff members from assisting industry professionals as they transition into the teaching profession to assisting members with certifications. Our CIA program works to, at the system level, to make sure that all staff members have everything that they need, whether it's tools and training, to make sure that students get what they need every single day. Our professional development kicks off in the summer, but it doesn't stop there. We have a PD Academy that kicks off with new teachers and a summit, and then all throughout the year, our specialist coordinators, directors, our on-campuses, in classrooms, coaching teachers, providing workshops, giving feedback. We were in over 2,000 classrooms this school year alone, and so it's really nice just to kind of get back in. This year, our second grade teachers finished off their reading academy, so this is rounding out year 3 of 4 for us, so that all of our K through 3 teachers will be certified in teaching foundational literacy. And then our GT program this year switched to the inclusion model, so we made sure that every single teacher was equipped to make sure that every single gifted and talented student is receiving 100% of their time and instruction in the area of their needs.
I've got priority 3, and that is inclusive and collaborative partnerships. CIA continued to grow our ever-expanding portfolio of partnerships department-wide this year. We were able to add partnerships with organizations such as Morning Wonderland and the Schaefer Library. This resulted in over 300 students being placed into a workforce for experiential learning across the district. Our 1882 partnership with CAST Networks is in the works, and we are continuing all of our ongoing work with organizations like UT Teen Health, Pre-K for SA, and Raising Blended Learners to ensure that we have successful student outcomes. We're confident that all of the partnerships that we're developing in ECISD are preparing all of our students for very bright futures.
So as evidence of how our sub-departments work together as a unified CIA department is in the contributions to our district's priority 4. Resources and operational excellence. For example, special ed department purchased new buses for the district. CIA purchased state-of-the-art learning environment for Sinclair Elementary early childhood students. Our CTMR department used their CTE summer grant for their internship program and their PTEC grant for the development of their PTEC development for next year. Our bilingual ESL department purchased technology for emergent bilinguals and met with their families to inform them on how we will support them for their English language development. So these are a few of the examples of how, even though we're separate sub-departments, we all come together as a unified CIA department to meet the needs of all of our students and ESL.
In summary, this picture represents our amazing group of educators who work tirelessly and have already jumped into next year's planning to continue working tirelessly to support our educators, our teachers, and our staff to achieve each of those goals and our priorities to generate well-rounded students, but not only students who are well-rounded, but they're prepared. Prepared for post-secondary outcomes, prepared for their employment experiences, and connected to their community. We're excited for our next chapter and moving into the 22-23 school year. Thank you.
That's my wonderful team. I get to work with every day. Do y'all have any questions for us? Yes.
I have a quick question.
Sure.
In regard to the keeping the high-performing engaged workforce, what kind of issues were you faced as far as keeping teachers or helping the community engaged?
What their needs were. Every individual's needs were a little bit different. Some people just needed an extra pair of hands. When our enrollment bolstered up, we had to add new pre-K teachers. It was our specialists coming in. the day before a teacher arrived and getting the classroom set up, or coming in the first day and just helping students transition to meet their new teacher because they got, you know, situated with one classroom and now they moved to another classroom. So the specialist just became a second and third teacher in the room for as long as it took until that teacher felt comfortable, so the students felt comfortable. In other situations, it was getting used to new resources or even new student behaviors that were happening in the classrooms. So our specialists and our coordinators just kind of jump in, and if it's working with teachers to help make sure they understand the material, or even going in and teaching a lesson for them so they can see it, covering the class so a teacher can go in and watch another master teacher do that, really whenever it needed. Even one of the big things this year with lack of subs meant that our specialists spent quite a bit of time substituting. Our instructional technology specialist was a PE sub for a couple of days, and so they just jumped in. When we had a tragic situation at Tradition, the whole first floor of one wing was just for the entire day, just specialists coming in and teaching the class for the day so that the teachers can do what they need to do to support their community. So it's really just been on the past meeting.
Thank you for that. I appreciate that.
District annually participates in several federal pilot programs. These applications need to be submitted by July 1st, and they're available for public viewing. They're available in my office, as well as the Director of Federal Programs, Coordinator of Federal Programs Office, in curriculum. So these entitlements include IDEA Part B, Title 1 Part A, Title 1 Part C, Title 2 Part A, and so on. You're very familiar with these entitlements and your specific intentions. The point here is that publicly we need to make sure that they're available, but also that we're using those funding sources in an effort to enhance support and opportunities for students that they're intended to serve, not to supplant the revenue that we allocate for supporting those students in those programs. And they also have to be spent in alignment with the way that we vote the application, the grant application. And that the way we write the grant application is reflected in the way that we built our campus improvement plan. So once we go through our needs assessment, identify our priorities and our needs, then those things show up in our campus improvement plan, and those things are reflected in our entitlement grant applications. And so that's the way that we ensure that they're enhancements, not supplants, they're not utilized as supplanted dollars, and that they're utilized in a manner that we actually need them based on our needs assessment. So again, the applications are due July 1st. We'll have them submitted on time, and they will be made available for the public and yourself in my office and coordinator of the federal program office. Glad to answer your question.
All right. 7.6, 2021-2022 district external school board for the board update.
Yeah, for this item, I would like to invite the one and only, the one to come in, the amazing and tall and handsome Jonathan Holmes to the podium, please.
I appreciate that.
Let's get down to the room.
I've got two pieces for you today. A little bit of a contrast. I'm going to do the mandatory TEA assessment, and then I'm going to pivot into that external scorecard.
That's good.
So thank you, Nancy Goldman, for supporting this, Mr. Scott, for that opportunity. And I want you to notice the stark contrast in these two sets of slides. So this is the required slides on our assessment. So I'm going to briefly go over our 3-day STAR results and our STAR AOC results. And the way I organized it here was looking at the current year, 22, last year where we had COVID, back in July of 21. We didn't test in 2020, so there's no 2020 data. So we used 2019 as just our context, sometimes just saying, what was it like pre-COVID? And so what I want you to see here is we've got a lot of our performance this year. You'll we saw that during COVID, math numbers nationally declined more than reading numbers did, and that they're a little slower to recover. So you can see that. You can see that in the data. Sixth grade math is interesting. Look at sixth grade math there. It's actually higher than pre-pandemic levels. Part of that, we think, is because of our work with Bellwether. So we got a partnership where we've been working, being super clear, and working on great lesson plans and coaching for our teachers. And we're seeing kind of a historic high mark for our sixth grade math performance. So coincide with that. Now, reading is a little bit more of a bounce back. In spots, you'll see like fourth grade is higher than it was in 2019. Let's see, I believe sixth grade and seventh grade are also higher than they were in 2019. So you can see that reading's kind of starting to really bounce back. Pivoting over 3 to 8, looking at science and social studies, you can see that it's a little bit more maybe like math, where it's bouncing back, but not as much as reading has. A note for the science, we have an increasing number of students in 8th grade taking biology and being successful there. And as we take some of our higher performing students in biology, earning that high school credit, it's starting to have a little bit of a negative effect on the 8th grade scores, but a positive effect on the biology scores, if that makes sense. Moving over to looking at POC results. POC results, you're going to see that in spots, it looks like we didn't have as much, but you kind of have to ask for some of it. So, like, looking at when you have to go across, like English 2 has been pretty consistent through the pandemic, right? It's within like a percent or so through the whole time. Algebra, as we've done algebra for all, you're seeing more and more kids at the middle school level being successful at it, but less in the high school. So high school numbers look like they're declining, but it's not as much high school declining as you have the highest kids already earning the algebra credit. And so it's a little bit deceptive when you look at some of the scores. Same thing with biology, like I referenced before. You're seeing a decline in high school biology scores that partly is explained through the success at middle school. And I added on here, just like 8th grade scores just for context. So looking at those 8th grade scores, what I want you to notice here is that our algebra is actually almost to the 2019 level. Legacy was actually a couple points higher than they were in 2019. Heritage had been so high in 2019 that they haven't quite gotten back up to that same level yet, but they're well on their way. And then looking at biology there, as the numbers continue to increase, so we had 257 take it in 2021, 284 this year. So more kids took it, and then the pass rate went from 89% to 94%. So you can see we're having more success there. If you look at all of middle school, it was over 770 EOC tests were passed where kids earned the credit and the test in 8th grade. And so that's the most we've ever seen, so that's a nice celebration. And that's what I have for you on state testing. For the mandatory side, I'm going to pause there so if you have any questions about STAR. Okay, sounds good. Then the thing that I'd way rather talk to you about is what our community asked for, right? So our community has the oral accountability system. And so this is one that Shannon usually gives you a tour through, and she said, Jonathan, you're up. We get to do it this time. So I'm going to give you a quick little tour. Just your laugh. I'm just going to give you some quick reminders. On the left, you see our categories. These are the big areas we chose. We call it coordinated that. So the yellow ones are priority one. Blue, you've got priority 2, red, you've got priority 3, and priority 4. From where I sit, it was fantastic with the departments have been doing, where they're talking that same language and presenting through the same filter. So I'm super proud of the work that they're doing there. So this card here shows all of the campuses across the top. And then at the end, we've got the three main departments, the business office, CIA, and the CE. And what you can start to see is some trends. So you can see like the 3.3. So that's going to be a popular one. Talking about growing and achieving. So as you can see from our STAR data and then our other data also, it's been a tough time for kids all throughout the country. And so you'll see a lot of the time people are at an A where they're making adjustments. I would say 10 out of 10, I think 10 campuses had an A for adjustments. One of them was saying, hey, we really want to call you more attention. So they put the SR for support request in, saying that's something they really want to focus on. Down at the bottom, you can see what those letters mean, where A is adjustments, S is support requested, C is like it's a crisis, and OTs are on track. And then they forecast out that by color is like how big of a thing is it that you're working on. So they look multiple years out and say, we think that this is something where we're more maintaining what we're doing is one of these blue colors. It's a little bit bigger change, but we call it a minor change, it's more green, so that's kind of the plan. And the orange ones are like a really, really big focal area, sort of making big changes. And so if you kind of look across, you can see kind of where the focus is, where the attention is. Okay, so what I did was I was able to sit with each of the campuses over the last few days. And they made some notes, and so I've got a couple of highlights, and so it's on the link here too, where you can kind of see some of the big ideas of what they experienced, and I'm just going to kind of share a couple of stories and some of the things that they had for you from the department, so like two or three quick notes from different groups. So talking to the business office, I didn't get to sit with all the departments, because they were gracious enough to share notes with me, and so I'm going to try to share some of these. They're really working on retention and recruitment, which I know you guys were just asking about, and that they're adjusting the protocols to try to reflect the market and make sure that we're in the market for each job and continue to be their goal. And so they're working on appropriate expenditures within each of their sub-departments. They want to make sure that employees have the resources they need to be successful in their positions. And one of their things they're working on is their needs assessment, budgeting, and the analysis, trying to look at their resources and lining that up with their goals. And so I think that's one of the big things that I've been really judicious about, how you're spending the money and lining it up to your work. Pivoting over to CIA, what we found from when we were looking at All Means All, we looked at trying to improve our systems. And one of the things that we saw was an opportunity to add a period in the day, so a secondary. They call it WIN, so what I mean. And so it's working on it's like an advisory period where every period, every kid will have it scheduled in at middle school and high school. So they'll have this time where they can kind of get support in areas trying to accelerate their instruction and help them. So we're guaranteeing that every kid in East Central from kindergarten to 12th grade is going to have that time next year. And when I get to some of the campuses, you'll hear a reference that WIN period, talking about that guaranteed time. And so we're in terms of growing and achieving, we're celebrating that we're able to close some of those gaps. And you saw a little bit of that in the data. We had high academic growth. In many ways, it's record amounts of growth, and we're kind of closing that gap again based on our end-of-year assessments. But in terms of our support, we were looking at it, and we haven't quite reached, we're not reaching the level where every kid's on grade level yet. And so we're still working on trying to get all of our kids on track. And so while we closed the gaps this year, we still haven't reached that level yet. So our achievement isn't there yet, even though our growth is getting closer. Looking at SCE, one of the things that they're celebrating over at SCE was that work on our leadership definition. And so they were able to kind of pilot a couple campuses working through that and complete it. They've really been working on kind of iterating that process and working on campus and leader profiles being developed and trying to work on rubrics or the competencies for that leadership definition. So that's exciting work I think over the next year for us. Another thing they wanted to draw attention to was campuses with support from appropriate departments and the work with family engagement. And so I know John Hernandez was instrumental in the work presenting from the beginning of the year through the whole year on family engagement and helping the district align to those best practices. And pivoting over to the third thing I wanted to talk about was planning and development systems and structures for East ISD's DAVP next year as we transition that. And they wanted to really call attention to, it's the second time, I think, today I'm mentioning Sarah, our USCL coordinator, super excited about her. They wanted to talk about how beneficial working with her has been. She's a star to keep an eye on, and they talked about Marcom and their quarterly newsletter that they have. That's going to be coming for you. Pivot now over to some campuses. So looking at Harmony, they were looking at positive impact on stakeholders, and one of the things they wanted to draw attention to there was how hungry the community was to get back in school, right? It was really hard during COVID, even at the beginning of the year, they didn't completely have access, but we were able to open up more and more and get a little bit more back to normal. So Harmony was celebrating partnerships. They had 65 partnerships with the community. They were celebrating, they rebooted their BPA, they had some events. Planning to have a bunch of new events next year, one of them being a community garden. And so it's something they were excited about. And looking at the exemplifying EC leadership learning leader, they reflecting on that, felt like they could make that more prominent, make that a little bit better featured, and communicate that more with the campus. So they want to make sure that they're leveraging that fully. In terms of training and developing staff, one of the things they were proud of was high levels of retention. Most of the people who left the campus this year left because they got a promotion. And so that's something to celebrate, that they were growing people. And that they've been doing a lot of training, where they do like twice a month. They customize that training based on people's needs. And I think that in COVID times where it's been very challenging, maybe helping fill people's needs is part of the reason why maybe people are comfortable there, and kind of powered some of the success and the growth that they had this year. In terms of aligning resources prioritize goals, they focused on utilizing high-yield instructional resources, and they felt like they did the best job they've ever done at kind of lining up how they spent their money in order to get those resources. And the last thing they wanted to share was about supporting student progress. So they called it Find Out Friday. So Find Out Friday. So they tied campus goals in every hallway, track progress towards the goal as a whole. And so everybody kind of had a sense of community. And so each kid could see how they were doing, and the classroom could see how they were doing, the hallway could see how they were doing, the school could see how they were doing. And so they could all track their progress and make it a little visible. And so it goes really tightly along with their proficiency scale assessments, where they're measuring their grading and making super clear about what kids need to learn, what's next in the learning, and how are we all doing. I think that maybe helped power some of their breakthroughs this year. I'm going to pivot over to Oakcrest. So Oakcrest was talking about student learning and achievement. You can see the growth mindset, their language. They were saying, look, Oakcrest did not yet reach all of their goals in achievement. They were one of our highest scoring campuses this year, but they have that not yet attitude always. And they said that while students had record amounts of growth at the measure, they're still working on trying to get the achievement level up. But just like you said, CIA. But I believe one of the important factors was teachers helping students set small goals. So a little bit like what we said with Don Farris, the more that kids were able to set goals for teachers, and then the teachers were able to set goals and kind of a goal. We sometimes talk about the cascade of the district goal, campus goals, department goals, teacher grade level goals, and kids' goals. And as we align all that together, that alignment is helping them achieve that high level goal.
So, trustees, you've seen this each quarter, and the interesting thing is if you go back to quarter one for a particular campus and kind of track the things that they've been paying attention to all year, you can kind of see the progress that the campus has made with respect to the community-based accountability key questions. So again, you had kind of tell the two accountability systems that you're dealing with the state that we've driven by standardized testing, and then you're dealing with a more complete accounting that our community says there's a whole lot more we want to know about the effect of our supports on our students. And so this piece is, and so when you look at the testing data, it's one small piece of the story, then when you use this tool, you all have access to your electronic packet. You can kind of look kind of laterally from quarter one through quarter four. You can kind of see the story of every campus. John's did a really good job of highlighting each from quarter four, but the real story is when you look at the trajectory from quarter one to quarter four for each area of the community, right, for each school and for our big department. So, if you want John to keep going through each campus, you can get access to it. But I just want to encourage you, kind of now that we're through quarter four, really now you can kind of see the whole picture. I appreciate this. John, be happy to answer my questions.
I love that the focus is not solely on that all campuses are getting the clubs, the community events, the PTA, that is amazing. I would say that when the kids are engaged with that, I think they're better in classroom, testing, they're happy, with their minds and their hearts.
Sir, you serve a high level, so you did. What's up?
Okay.
move on to 7.7, upcoming events.
Just a couple items there for a calendar, your miscellaneous packet. The district is closed through the month of July on Fridays, 14-hour days for energy savings, but also it helps us get projects done more efficiently. Also on the 20th, just a reminder, trustees, you called for a special board meeting. That'll be the student services building where our last special meeting was at 5:30. Then in July. Then in July, DLT, our district leaders come back to their leadership retreat on the 13th and 14th, and Mr. Maskell, of course, all the board is invited. You can spend a few minutes that morning and address very much from the calendar and see if you're able to do it this year. And then our new teachers return on the 26th, and your next regularly scheduled meeting is the 28th. But off your calendars, in August, we want to make sure you know August 2nd. August 2nd is our annual kickoff at the Patterson, and it's at 8 a.m. And that's we'll have the Patterson pool. We'll also be streaming the kickoff event to campuses as well, so you can learn it. But 800 or 900 folks will be in Patterson, the rest of the employees will be streaming it. Questions about the next video on time?
The new teachers.
Yes, sir. New teachers who are 4 of 26. Oh, yeah. A lot of things to outreach to the city. That was positive. That. Yes, sir. Outreach to the city dates. Not necessarily always the end. As you're aware, we've been accelerating the process of completing all of our projects that are associated with district-wide hail damage from the spring of 2021. One of the things that the board approved in January was for us to get the ball rolling on the work in Legacy and not waiting on the insurance plan check. And so we fronted that money knowing that that money's coming back from the insurance plan. So we're continuing with the second phase of that work. It's an additional $1.3,055,000, and of course, all of that is coming back from the claim. However, in order to coordinate all of these projects and take advantage of times like this in the summer when students aren't there to get things done, our strategy is to again use fund balance dollars to get the work done, knowing that we'll be reimbursed. But in addition, we're working on a few other projects, much smaller, but they accumulate to $166,110, and that's a few projects we're getting done over the summer. One is to add some workspace for our curriculum instruction team. We're calling it the Curriculum Studio. It's formerly a record storage, kind of storage building in the back. We're able to put between 10 and 12 employees in there. Have workspaces, they work on curriculum instruction related items as we grow. We're also going to be doing some work in the back here. We have a small kitchen back there that is on the verge of being shut down. So we've got to do some renovations there so we can continue to utilize that as a kitchen. And then we're doing some work to enhance the wastewater treatment equipment and tradition. And so we're getting at that in some of our students aren't all in the building. And so all in all, the net is $166,110. But for the purposes of this particular fiscal record, it's also showing the $1.355,000. But again, just a reminder that $1.355,000 is all coming back from the insurance claim. And so when you look down at the ledger, you'll see that the increase is $1.3 million. about $55,000, and then the additional increase to $1.5,021,110. The difference between those two is at $166,110. Not sure if you care for all that detail, however, I wanted to make sure that we had it in case you had any questions. Mr. President, I recommend board approval of budget amendment 2021-2022 number 5, local maintenance, as presented.
We have a recommendation from the superintendent to approve the budget amendment 2021-2022 number 5, local maintenance, as presented. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
I have a motion from Mr. Victor Garza. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a second from Ginger Friedland. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Move on to 8.2, 2022-2023 employee compensation schedule. Mr. Scott.
Yes, sir. Mr. President, trustees, you do have a copy of the 2022-2023 salary schedule in your electronic packet. You also have a hard copy in the miscellaneous packet. The majority of what I'm sharing tonight is what you approved in January that you've already communicated with our staff. This was a commitment of the board over 2 years to get all of our employees at market comparability, but also our instructional staff, particularly teachers, at a competitive position as it related to the other 17 ISDs in the San Antonio area. We knew it was going to take a substantial investment over 2 years to get back in the game, if you will. So just to highlight a few things, we moved starting teacher salary from $54,100 to $56,000. Teachers this year, again, are receiving a true 5% increase from their 21-22 salary. That's an average increase for a teacher, depending on where they are in years of service, of a little over $3,000. We are commissioning a TASB salary study in December, which we do usually biannually, and this is, again, to make sure that across all work categories and job classifications that we are market competitive. Moving into administrative, we did increase our minimum midpoint max for administrative pay ranges this year, and this year we'll receive 3% of that new increase midpoint. Moving to auxiliary and paraprofessional instructional employees, all of those employees, the lowest starting pay for any employee in any of those groups is $15, up from $12 an hour to be competitive. That's a 25% increase in the minimum range, meaning that the midpoint and maximum also increase. And they'll see a 5% increase of the new midpoint. So there was in some cases, quite a bit of a salary increase for some employees, depending on the pay range they were in para-instructional and auxiliary categories. Looking at para-support, this would be clerical or office support. The lowest entry-level pay was $14.84 an hour. It's now $16.25, which similarly moves the minimum, subsequently the midpoint, the maximum for those pay grades up. And so for the new midpoint, they're receiving a 5% increase on that. And for our drivers, they're receiving a 15% increase in pay. We know that drivers are hot commodities, not just in schools, school bus drivers, but truck drivers. And so we're moving our route pay from $79.12 a day to $91.12 a day, and our monitor is up from $60.29 a day to $72.29. This is for each route. Then we're increasing the longevity incentive by 10 cents along each step. And then for field trips, extra duties, driving teams to games, fans to events, and we're also making that minimum of $15 an hour. In our tech department, we're moving the lowest entry level position from $18.59 starting to $21.59 starting. And then for other areas of compensation, our teachers who provide services to students who are homebound, that increased to $45 an hour, and that includes their travel. Tutoring in summer school is up to $40 an hour. Our mileage reimbursement, we were $50 an hour for many, many years, $50 a mile for far too long. The national standard is 57 cents a mile now, so we've bumped up to 55. And then we're increasing our contracted police officers $2 an hour for ensuring that they compete with what the market is, when they're doing traffic or additional security detail. And then there's a group of employees that are just the most in demand. psychologists, our speech therapists, our occupational therapists, and physical therapists. They're very sought after in the private sector. And so to remain competitive with those groups, we've adjusted their contract, start wins, and extend contracts in some cases. But most importantly, we changed their stipends. So we had stipends for first-year employees in any of those roles. They were $8,000 the first year, $9,000 the second year, and $10,000 the third. Starting next year, first year in any of those roles, the stipend will move from $8,014 from $9,016 and from $10,018. And that now that by doing that, that puts us in the competitive range with both the private sector and other ISDs in the area for those particular groups of employees. And so that's a high-level summary. It's a lot of changes, but I'm confident in presenting that to you. That we're comparable with the market in every class of employee, and we're in the top third as it relates to instructional staff and school leadership in the San Antonio area. So it takes salary off the table. It's just up to us to make sure that what we have is a really high-level, satisfying work in our teaching position. So it's our job to make sure all the great people in the room are providing the support, the resources, and the direction that these employees need to be satisfied and want to choose to continue to be in this enterprise. If you leave with this tonight, salary's off the table. It's not the reason people leave the job. The salary study will be committed. We're on the books in December. We actually booked it almost a year ago. As you get on the books in December, and that will inform this information by this time next week. We'll be able to bring you something back to the base. Mr. President, I recommend board approval of the 2022-2023 employee compensation schedule as presented.
Is there anyone?